in our the scriptures are pandemics being described like two, three different things over here. First is the Vedic texts, they don't give a exhaustive account of history. They give a purposeful account of history. See, the purpose is to demonstrate, or to describe events in the history of humanity where humanity rose to morality and spirituality. So, for example, times when the divine descended to the world, or times when those who were virtuous, they acted in special ways. So it's not a chronological history of all events. So in that sense, there could have been pandemics and they may not be described. So it's a selective description of history, and it's selected based on whatever serves a spiritual purpose. That's the first point to understand with respect to our scriptures. Second point is that it's also to be understood that diseases don't just occur in a vacuum. There's a famous doctor and you could say a medical scientist, René Dubois, who wrote Health in the 21st Century, The Future of an Illusion. So that book basically talks about that we may say that by scientific advancement, we removed the Black Plague, or we removed this, we almost eliminated smallpox, we eliminated. And he says, yes, that is only part of the story. He said that diseases arise because of certain socio-economic, socio-cultural situations. And when those socio-cultural situations change, the diseases also go away. So for example, the plague that was caused by the rats. So now, as human society moved towards a more urbanized setting, as even agriculture changed into agribusiness, so rats became less prevalent. And therefore, diseases coming by rats also became less likely. So the point is that diseases are, while the principle of disease is something which will always be there dogging humanity, but the specific diseases that we get are don't exist in a vacuum. They arise because of certain socio-cultural, socio-economic, socio-political factors. So you can say this particular pandemic, even if a pandemic like this had occurred in the past, now it is now that human society, at least from the perspective of recorded human history, has been far more connected than in the past. Because of that connectedness, this connectedness is because of trade, it is because of tourism, it is because of immigration. So even in the past, an epidemic had occurred. The Black Plague actually spread because there were not just traders, there were political conquests and so many people went across. That's how the plague spread, but it spread slowly because we were so interconnected. That's why the epidemic, wherever it started in Wuhan or wherever, from wherever it started, it just spread across the world so rapidly before we could come across anything. So the scale and the speed of the spread of this pandemic is a result of the socio-economic factors that we have in the world today. And when there are not similar socio-economic factors, there will be distress, there will be disasters, there will be diseases, but they'll be of different forms in different parts of the world. So we could say this is a product of the socio-economic situation. That's the second point. And third point would be that certainly the pandemic that we have is huge, and for most of us in our memory we have never seen anything like this,
right?
But it's not like that in 1920s. There were issues. If you look at even last century, there were epidemics, but they didn't spread so fast across the world, and they didn't cause as much damage as they did because of our particular situation. So I would say that even human memory is not that sharp all the time. So apart from the scriptural records, if you look at other historical record also, how much of a historical record do we really have? Especially if we consider from the perspective of Indian history, for a long time, the Saraswati River was considered to be a mythological river. But it is only maybe a decade or so ago that American probes over the Thar desert, over the desert in Rajasthan, they found below the earth the remnants of a very extraordinarily large river. In fact, the riverbed was so large that there are evidences of houses being on the riverbeds. That means what happened was the riverbed was very large at one time. Then people normally live on the coast. Then as the river becomes smaller, then the people start coming closer. So what was the riverbed earlier becomes the riverbank. So people were living on the riverbank and they lived for so long that the imprints, the remnants of their houses are still there on the ground over there. And then eventually the river dried up completely. So I would say in general, the state of archaeological research in India is quite underdeveloped. So from historical research, were there colossal health calamities like this? Who knows, in future research may tell us more about not just the empirical historical findings may come through archaeology, but who knows, we may find further documents. We know actually it's, if we consider from the historical perspective, it's a significant miracle that the Vedic culture has survived despite nearly 1,000 years of aggression, vandalism, persecution. And so in India being a tropical country, leaves on which books were written, they themselves don't last. And on top of that, if there are aggressors trying to destroy the culture, destroy the wisdom, then they don't last. Then that will also happen. And even they don't destroy, if they don't support financially, then maintaining them also will become difficult. So in spite of that, we have a significant body of scriptures still remaining. The commentators on scriptures, if you look at Madhvacharya or Jiva Goswami, they say that basically what we have now is barely 1-5% of the broad Vedic canon of scriptures. So many are lost. So there could be descriptions in those texts also.